We wanted to make this a little bit controversial. So what I personally believe is two types of anastomosis. In the patients that are sick, that I do an end-to-end hands-on anastomosis. And on an otherwise healthy patient, that I like to make the anastomosis as a end-to-site. And I do believe the fact that this is better than the side-to-side anastomosis, where Phil is going to be defending from his part, and we'll go over there. I have nothing to disclose. So let's talk about the terminology very briefly, because it can be very confusing. So when we use or define the anastomosis, that first thing what we do is we talk about the part of the intestine, we're putting that together, the proximal part first, going to the distal. Then we can use in different sequence, whether it's a stapled, or is done a hands-on, and which anatomic region of the bowel that we're using. And again, we use that again, just like the top, which part we're using, proximal to distal. We can also add the concept of peristaltic, such as isoperistaltic or antiperistaltic. That is not that commonly used, but this three part is commonly used. So let's give you an example. This is an end to end stapled colorectal anastomosis. So why? This is a rectal tumor case. We're taking the colon out. We brought the staple, so it's a stapled anastomosis. We're bringing the proximal part, colon, which is the end of the colon, and it's going to the end of the rectum, and that's the reason it's called end to end stapled colorectal anastomosis. Okay? So the proximal first goes to distal. So when do I do which type of anastomosis? As what I said, if it's a non-complicated patient with bowel discrepancy, remember we're talking about ileocolic anastomosis here, not the other type of anastomosis. Ileocolic anastomosis. So the small bowel lumen is small, large bowel lumen is large. So that's the reason when there's a size discrepancy, I think the stapled anastomosis is really good here. If it's a complicated case with tissue quality, and usually in this case the small bowel is really dilated, it has been working against the Crohn's related obstruction, and the tissues are thin, then in that case I do a hands-on, end-to-end ileocolic hands-on anastomosis. So why do I do this? Okay, so this is my defending things against the Dr. Fleschner. So when you do a side-to-side anastomosis, which he's going to talk about, that you come across staple line with another staple. To me, I do think that may be a little bit concern for sign of area of ischemia that may you leak, because you're using a staple to come across another side of the staple. And when you do these like side-to-side anastomosis, it's like creating a dead man curve on I-90 that may be a cause of this chronic stasis or slowing down at this area that may explain some of our patients' post-operative pain-related issues. And also, for your sake, that when you come back to do a dilatation or to do an endoscopy, when you have a side-to-side anastomosis and that area strictures, it may be really tough to get in the small bowel. And I do think for a therapeutic approach, if you have an end-to-end anastomosis, that you dilate that thing, it is less of a hassle for you. Or a end-to-side anastomosis, you have only one lumen. You don't have one side colon, the other side is small bowel. You can just dilate that area. So it creates a less hostile environment for our gastroenterologic colleagues and partners for evaluation and dilatation of the anastomosis. The other thing is, again, we talked about this, the art of colorectal surgery is to think 2-3 steps ahead. So when you need to come back, if I have to come back, if Dr. Fleschner put the side of the bowel there in the colon, I'm worried that I may have to be taking more small bowel than my anastomosis that I'm defending. So I think I have a concern it may, you know, bring a more small bowel that needs to be removed. I mean, the idea behind this thing, a lot of people thought about if you make the anastomosis larger, you have a less chance of recurrence, because it's not true. Most of the time, the disease comes back not at the anastomosis, pre-anastomotic. So I also want to avoid an unnecessary throw away of the small bowel. So for that reason, I do recommend this two anastomoses that I define. But more important than anything, whatever the type of anastomosis, two things that we need to do: the colon or the anastomosis cannot look like that. On attention, with a poor blood supply, they die, they leak. They need to have a very relaxed, minimal tension, with a good blood supply, so they can heal. So this is the one that I do on a non-complicated cases, which is end of the small bowel to the side of the colon. So it is called an end-to-side stapled ileocecal anastomosis. So this is what I like to do most of the time. Okay? And sometimes I close the other staple. So by this way, the staple is not going through the other line of the staple. To me, I think that's the technically important thing. So you close the defect. When you close the defect, you're done. So this is the simulation of that thing. This is called an end-to-side stapled ileocecal anastomosis. This is a staple gun which has a capability of a circular cutting and stapling. So by this way, the technique itself didn't come across the colon and the small bowel staple line. We put the staple away from the other staple line so we can come across with no problem in the setting. So this is what I like. Think about this thing as an ileum to colon, that if the tissues are bad, the bowel size discrepancy is minimal due to chronic bowel obstruction related to Crohn's disease. I put the things and do a hand-sewn anastomosis with a good old grandma technique. I do believe the fact that if the tissues are not good, it is okay to use this technique. It's still much safer than any other, you know, the staples that we have. Now, this is the thing that Dr. Flesch is going to talk about. This is a side-to-side stapled ileocecal anastomosis, a different way of doing this thing. Do you see what I'm talking about? That you bring the staple together, you use a stapler to come across, and people sometimes call this a functional end-to-end. I think it's a very wrong terminology. This is a side-to-side stapled ileocecal or ileal anastomosis. So did you see how those staples went back into the area of the staples? And that's my very technical concern in this thing. And then the other thing is, you know, that you leave that long segment of the small bowel that you need to get in when the disease happens in the proximal part, that it will be tough to get in there, and it may also create, look at the unnecessary amount of small bowel that you may have to be resecting, comparing to the beautiful techniques that I described. Think about that. Now, this is also the point that I made. When you do these side-to-side anastomosis, do you see this dead man's curve? Like how the stool gets stuck. This patient was operated by 7 times. Someplace from the East Coast came after 7 times that he was operated. They cannot find what's wrong with me. They tell me that I come in obstructed. They can never find an obstruction. What his problem was, side-to-side anastomosis creates this. Think about it. You have a tough stool. How you're going to negotiate that? Sometimes it gets plucked. I mean, when you're running, when you have a wall in front of you, you have to slow down. That's true for stool too. So I don't like this side-to-side anastomosis. Why? And why the type of the anastomosis matter? Because as a surgeons, when we work together, because we have to deliver to our patients, okay, there are short-term complications and the long-term recurrence related to Crohn's disease and the ileocecal disease, which is the number one disease. Well, when you look at the literature out there, and despite what Professor Fleschner is going to tell you, there is barely any randomized prospective study out there, okay? So this is a study that will tell you the fact that I'm wrong. You know, it's a retrospective study, compared patients with stapled side-to-side anastomosis, hand-sewn, 69 patients, recurrent disease occurred in the end-to-end anastomosis, much higher comparing to the, you know, the side-to-side anastomosis. And in this group, they also said that overall complications rate was much higher, okay? But when you look at a level one evidence that Robin McLeod from Toronto led this trial from five large centers from Canada and US, it's a CAS trial, they looked at the complications comparing end-to-end hands-on anastomosis versus side-to-side stapled anastomosis. This is a level one evidence. And why did they do the study? Because the idea was to decrease the surgical recurrence of these patients so we don't have to operate frequently. The hypothesis was that the side-to-side anastomosis, where they used a 100 millimeter or a 10 centimeter linear stapler to make the anastomosis, by making a large anastomosis, that you would be leaving a much bigger area. It's going to take much longer time for the disease to recur and cause a problem. But hypothetically, it turned out to be wrong. It didn't work out. And this is the level one study. Overall complications were similar between the two groups. Anastomotic complications related to leak between the group seemed to be head-to-head. And also the no difference in endoscopic and symptomatic recurrence in these settings. Why? Disease happens pre-anastomotic. And those patients unfortunately lost 10 centimeters of extra of the small bowel that they may not need to. So this is the way how I feel. So repeating to what I said, just to be clear, in a non-complicated patient with bowel discrepancy in size with and colon small bowel, I do an end-to-side stapled anastomosis. And complicated case with tissue quality, no bowel discrepancy in size within colon small bowel, I do an end-to-end hand-sewn ileocecal anastomosis itself. The reasons is what I said for the things that I emphasized, not to come across the staple with another stapler, avoid the stasis of the sutural passing through, help you out to be able to dilate these things, I think, in an easier way, and minimize the amount of the small bowel needs to be resected for surgical recurrence. I'm very much grateful for all your time listening to me. Thank you so much for your attention.